Hey everybody, Brion McClanahan here. The woke madness in history education is off the rails. Well, how do we change it? McClanahanacademy.com. And because you listen to this podcast, if you use the coupon code PODCAST at checkout, you get 25% off every day, all day, 365 days a year on every class at McClanahanacademy.com. So go to McClanahanacademy.com, use coupon code PODCAST at checkout, and get a real history education at 25% off. If you like this podcast and you want it without advertisements, head over to patreon.com and become a member of the Brion McClanahan Show. For 10 bucks a month, you get all the podcasts ad-free, including video, and you also get a special Q&A podcast. I'm only going to answer your questions, your listener-generated episodes, through those Q&A. So head over to patreon.com, get this podcast ad-free, no ads, not even things like this, and you really do help support the Brion McClanahan Show with really cool stuff on the back end. The Founding Fathers are under attack. Who knew in 2009, when I wrote my first book, The Politically Incorrect Guide to the Founding Fathers, that George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, and a litany of the other Founding Fathers would be under assault today? Well, I did, and that's why I wrote that book. It's my first, it's still my bestseller. Go on out and pick it up whenever books are sold online. The Politically Incorrect Guide to the Founding Fathers. You'll really enjoy it. Mike Pence and other Republicans feel slapped in the face by Donald Trump, but Trump took the correct constitutional position. We'll talk about that on this episode of the Brion McClanahan Show.
It's time to think locally and act locally. Welcome to the Brion McClanahan Show.
Welcome back to the Brion McClanahan Show. Glad to be back on the program. Very glad to be here. All right, this episode is going to upset some people, just like the ones I do on the Second Amendment. Some people are going to be mad about what I'm going to say here. It has nothing to do with my own personal beliefs or your personal beliefs or anything else or a general policy. It has everything to do with federalism. Donald Trump took the correct position on the Dobbs decision the other day because he said abortions are under the purview of the states. That's the correct legal position. Now, what I saw with several conservative commentators, several conservative news outlets, also on the left, because now we have the Arizona issue where they've court has stepped in and said the 1864 law is now in effect in Arizona pending appeal. What we've got is a bunch of nationalists trying to decide for everyone else, just like with the situation of fossil fuels or gun control or take your pick, cancel culture, marriage, whatever it is. We have a bunch of nationalists trying to decide for 320 million people what's best when the majority is very, very slim. This is exactly what Calhoun pointed out in the disquisition and discourse. When we have these kind of issues, when we have very slim, razor slim numerical majorities, you're going to have tremendous conflict. And if we go back to the 1860s or the 1850s or the 1840s, 30s, and we look at the issues that were confronting America then, we can talk about some of them in moral terms or not. We know that in the case of slavery, we didn't really have that many people that were concerned about it morally. Some were not. Some looked at it in a moral position as being justified morally. So, I mean, we have two sides on this issue on moral terms, and we can weigh those arguments today in 2024, and people did, of course, in the 19th century as well. But the fact is, you look at the major conflicts of the period of the antebellum period, right, leading up to the war in 1861, and it was all about federalism. Everything. It didn't matter if it was something as benign as tariffs to many people. These were taxes, but of course, when you look at the impact of taxes and how that worked, and you look at a situation where you have a protective tariff that harms one section and helps the other, at least that was the argument, well, then we have a state issue. Or if we have federally funded internal improvements, the way that was sold, if we're going to pay for a road through the Cumberland Gap, which sounded like a great idea to help Western farmers, who's going to pay for it? Everybody. But who's going to benefit? Only a few people. This is still a state powers. It's still an issue of federalism. It's still an issue of an original construction of the Constitution. You look at the bank. Where's the power to charter the bank? And when you go back to McCulloch v. Maryland in 1819, what's happening there? Well, the state of Maryland is trying to tax the bank out of existence, an illegal corporation. It's saying, look, we're going to tax it. We're going to get rid of it. The state of Maryland is trying to assert its sovereignty to do this. And you can take your pick on a number of these issues, but you see the real problem in America is we have nationalists who don't really care for federalism when it doesn't suit their needs. We have inconsistent federalists. If you're going to be someone who believes in federalism, then you need to believe in federalism even when it doesn't go your way. That's the major political issue. When you go look at Roe v. Wade in 1973, it was an affront to federalism. It created powers or rights out of thin air that weren't there from the federal government. We can even look at issues like criminal law. There are very few statutes or very few parts of the Constitution that allow for federal statutes in criminal law. It doesn't exist. But the federal government has done it anyways. Creating massive police agencies like the FBI and the CIA, these things aren't constitutional, particularly the FBI. Maybe you could say the CIA has some military component to it as far as an intelligence gathering organization during wartime. But again, we're not at any war. There's no declared war. So when you have these intelligence gathering organizations, they should only be there if we have a declared war and we have some type of military necessity for it. Otherwise, what's there? Well, McClanahan, we have the Cold War. We have the War on Terror. Those are wars, undeclared wars. Yes, expanding the powers of the federal government beyond what they need to be. But again, this is the issue. It is always the issue. And so when you take these other things and throw them into the mix, the major issue, as Southerners pointed out going up to 1861, as Northerners pointed out before they became sectionalist nationalists, before they got the idea that nationalism could protect them, if they just became nationalists, they get their way. Well, they're really just sectionalists. Before everybody figured this out, the North was relying on the Constitution for defense. Think about the Embargo Act. During the Jefferson administration. The Embargo Act was unconstitutional. Virginians pointed this out, but so did New Englanders. They were all right. There was no power for the general government to say you can't trade with anyone. I mean, that was clearly unconstitutional. Trade had to remain free. I mean, you can look at these arguments as an expansion of federal power, as an affront to the understanding of the Federation of States and what the general government, which is the representatives of the states, can and cannot do. That's what all these issues boil down to. It's what it all comes down to. It doesn't matter what issue you're talking about. And if you're going to be a committed Federalist, there's going to be things that happen in other states that you don't like. And you have to work on your state. It's the ultimate expression of working through your local government, your state government, your county government, to get to have a government that reflects the will of the people of that state. And that way, Donald Trump's statement, which upset a lot of Republicans, is 100% spot on. It's the most Federalist thing he's ever said as president. Now, back in 2016, when I launched this podcast, either the first or second episode, I think it was episode one or two, I think it was episode one, was Donald Trump and federalism. This is when Trump was still candidate Trump, hadn't been elected yet. And I talked about Donald Trump. It was a short podcast. I talked about Donald Trump and federalism. And his position was at that time, well, we'll look into this. He didn't take any definitive stances on anything nationalist. We're just going to look into it. I think Trump has figured out that if you want a peaceful political situation, if you want a peaceful American polity, you're going to have to insist that Americans accept differences, real diversity, among the Federation of States when the federal power is incompetent or unconstitutional to do it. When I say incompetent, you can't have razor-thin majorities decide for the other, the 50% plus one decide for the other 50% and keep peace. And you can't use the powers of the central government to do something that in many ways, one half of the population or not, is going to oppose. You're going to have chaos. You're going to have a real difficult situation. And again, we tried this, right? We tried it for nearly 50 years. 50 years we tried it. And it had chaos all the time. So you have people like Steve Deese go on social media and say, and of course he has a very big following. I remember, I guess it was 2009 when Steve Deese was really nobody yet. I was on his show several times. Haven't been on his show since. But Steve Deese was, you know, just a local talk show host in Iowa, I think is where he was out of. Des Moines, Iowa, I believe. But he quoted Lincoln on this particular issue. We got to be like Lincoln. Now, what happened with Lincoln? Let's just take this and logically carry this forward. If the Republican Party acts like Lincoln on this issue, what's going to happen? Well, you could potentially see violence. I mean, the Lincolnian position was to enforce whatever federal edict, however constitutional or unconstitutional, on the rest of the Union. And it led to violence. The Lincolnian position, of course, and we take all these quotes and pumps, just like Jefferson. You can have a quote, or Franklin even. Benjamin Franklin does the same thing. You can pull a quote from any of these people to defend your position. Lincoln was so slimy and amorphous, there's nothing about Lincoln that's consistent. The only thing Lincoln was consistently in favor of was national power. Was not just that. National power that suited his political party. That's what Lincoln was in favor of. Whatever benefited the Republicans, at least in his mind, would have favored Lincoln. That's Lincoln's position. So this issue, whether you like it or not, comes down to the federal government not having the power to decide any of it. In fact, either side would need a constitutional amendment, just like we saw in the 13th Amendment, just like we saw in the 15th Amendment, just like we saw with the 19th Amendment or the 18th Amendment. Either side would need a constitutional amendment to come up with these powers. That's the amazing thing when you look at some of these other issues like decriminalization of drugs, which, I mean, we can talk about the moral ramifications of all of that. Some pretty tough things there. But when you go back to the 18th Amendment and the federal government saying, in order to ban alcohol, we need a constitutional amendment to do it. Well, why didn't they do that for any of the other controlled substances in America? They clearly needed the power. They clearly needed the authority to do something like that. There wasn't any constitutional amendment that allowed it to ban these controlled substances. I mean, it's not just about moving them across state lines. They're saying they're illegal to possess anywhere. Well, where is the power for them to do that? You see, we needed it with the 18th Amendment, but we don't need it with other controlled substances. That's a little odd, right? I mean, so we needed a constitutional amendment, the 13th Amendment, to abolish slavery. We needed that. They understood. The Republican Party was clear. We understand this is a state issue. The states can do whatever they want here, and we're fine with that. Again, there was an exchange on social media the other day with a guy, a little midwit, who thought he was pretty smart, was quoting David Wilmot of Pennsylvania. And Wilmot, who was famous for the Wilmot Proviso, which would have banned slavery in the territories acquired by the Mexican War, which did start a big firestorm debate in Congress about what was going to happen once the Mexican War was over and they were going to get all of this territory. How was it going to be organized? And of course, that led to several compromises, led to the Compromise of 1850, which was a series of laws. One of those, of course, was the admission of California. There were a lot of Southerners who were insisting at that time that California, it maybe even be divided, right? You have half the state be slave, half the state be free, or you can't really regulate slavery in California. There were Southerners that were interested in that. And Wilmot made a speech where he was critical of the South and their position. But he also said in that speech, he was duty bound, that's his words, he was duty bound to protect slavery in the states where it already existed. And it could exist for centuries there, as long as the South would allow for the rest of the United States, the free white people of the United States, to have an equal access to the government, meaning that you were going to have territories open to free white people only, he was fine with whatever happened in the South. He didn't care what happened in South Carolina or Alabama or Virginia or Mississippi, Texas, didn't care. So long as the rest of the territories stayed free and free white people had access to those territories. You see, his commitment to abolishing slavery wasn't really there. Even though he made some pretty interesting rhetorical flourishes in the speech where he talked about this is a duty to these people and how evil slavery was and he thought it was a bad thing, he was going to let it exist wherever it existed. As long as those people weren't trying to make it somewhere else, in his state, in his territory, he was okay with it. And that was the general Republican position in 1860 and 61. It's why they were willing to allow the Corman Amendment to pass the Congress. It passed the Congress. People don't realize this. The Republican-controlled Congress passed the Corman Amendment, which would have made slavery permanent in the South. Lincoln supported it. The Republican-controlled Congress, not the Democrat-controlled Congress, the Republican-controlled Congress. If you look at their 1860 platform, hey, we're all for the states having whatever powers and abilities they want on their own domestic concerns in their own states. We just don't want slavery in the territory. So you take that into the 21st century and you can apply that to any issue. But what we have now are committed nationalists on both sides who are willing to sacrifice the federal republic for whatever pet political project they have. Doesn't matter what that political project may be. It could be a social issue, as I said. It could be an economic issue. They want 535 people in Congress, along with the president, so 536, and 9 Supreme Court justices, so 545 people. And not even that. They want a simple majority of that 545 people. Just 5 justices, 1 president, and say 51 senators, whatever the number is in Congress, and divide that 435 in half, right? So what, 218 people? 218 people in the House, 51 in the Senate. So you got 269, 270, 275 people. 275 people get to decide what's best for 320 million. Now, does that sound very democratic? Would that be something that the founding generation would think is a good idea? We know they wouldn't. We know they wouldn't because they made statements about representative ratios and other things, and they would have thought that 275 people deciding for the rest of the United States, 320 million, would be awfully undemocratic. That would be awfully aristocratic, authoritarian, and frankly, bad government. Let's just look at George Washington. 40,000-to-1 representative ratio at the end of the Philadelphia Convention says that's too high. We need to cut it. Cut to 30,000-to-1. Madison proposed an amendment to kind of peg the ratio at a lower number. Didn't happen. We would have had a Congress of 10,000 people. I've talked about this on this episode, on this podcast before, excuse me. We had George Mason and others in the anti-federalists saying that even at the ratio they had, they didn't have representative government. You had too many aristocratical features of the Constitution to make it real representative government. You've got the left that's been running around for years. Recently, even people like Jamel Bowie, I've talked about him on this show, saying, oh my gosh, these things are too undemocratic. We can't have this. There's no democratic representation. And yet, they're okay for 275 people as long as the issue suits them. What they don't want to have happen, and as Trump points out in his little talk on this issue that he posted on Truth Media, Truth Social, what they don't want to have happen is the states, as Trump says, the people of the states. You can take this issue of, you know, you can use a legislature, you can use a referendum, You can use anything you want, any method of democracy, which is more direct and closer to the will of the people of those states than anything Washington, D.C. would do. You can use any of those methods, and we would abide by the will of the people in those states. That sounds very, very federalist. And it is. But people are losing their minds. Mike Pence, it's a slap in the face. That's his line. This is a slap in the face. Why? Because we don't have a committed policy, an unconstitutional committed policy, to say that the general government is going to legislate on something they have no power to do. Lindsey Graham comes out and says this is a slap in the face. Not that those terms, but Trump is not being very Republican-like. Well, I guess if you're Thad Stevens or Charles Sumner or all these other people that were willing to use unconstitutional power to disfranchise people, to use military coercion and military authority and Reconstruction and do other things which were completely anti-American, if that's what we're not going to be, that's great. See, Republicans have to make a choice. And if they are going to make a choice and be the Republican Party that's always existed, and that would mean the radical Republican Party, particularly after the war, well, then conservatives need to look at that and say, is this really conservative anymore? I understand it's supporting an issue that we like. I understand it's supporting an issue we want. But is it even, for conservatives or whoever you are, is that even an issue for the central government? If we're going to be committed federalists with a lowercase f and say, you know what? We want to have the ability to do these things in our states. And that is an affront to state sovereignty. I just talked about this yesterday with the fossil fuel industry, right? Hawaii's going after the Exxon and Chevron and all these companies. They're going to tax them to where it's going to create a chaotic situation where fossil fuels are so expensive people can't afford them. And all kinds of things. I mean, again, we're talking about plastics and everything else. If that's going to be the case, and we're going to issue from the state attorneys generals in these states, 20 of them, saying this is dangerous. Why wouldn't they do the same thing on this issue? Because it doesn't meet their political agenda. But if we're going to say this is an affront to state powers, then we have to say it even on issues we don't like. And the lefties out there who are going to go out and say, you know what, it's our right to ban firearms in the state of Hawaii. Hey, who came on to this show and said if Hawaii wants to do that, that is within their right. Right? If it's our right to do that, it's our right to regulate things that we don't like in our state. It's our right to decriminalize things we do want in our state. It's our right to do that. If they're going to come out and say that, then they need to be committed to federalism, even when it doesn't go their way, as it's not going their way in Arizona right now, or in Alabama or other places. And the people of those states can then decide if that's the proper course to take, without interference from California or Massachusetts or New York. This is the way it works. It's the way it has to work. It's the way the founding generation designed it to work. Because, as we know, in 1787, in 1788, the states didn't agree on a whole lot of things. It's why they left domestic concerns, which were many, to the will of the people of the states and the state constitutions. That's what happened. You go back to the Massachusetts Ratifying Convention and you read it, and there were questions. Why do we want to be in a union with slaveholders? And the answer was, well, we're not. I mean, it doesn't really matter because they can't do anything to us. They can't regulate the institution here in Massachusetts. We can do whatever we want. Why do we want that? We can do whatever we want about this. Same thing with Connecticut. We can do whatever we want about that issue. It doesn't really matter because, well, we can't affect them and they can't affect us. South Carolina, there were people that brought up, why don't we be in a union with these people in Massachusetts who are going to try to regulate this? Nah, it's not going to happen. That won't happen. Don't worry. No power in the central authority to do it. They can't do anything about it. You see, there's nothing there. These people were committed federalists. They were committed federalists with a lowercase f. a federal republic. Just as we had on the Articles of Confederation, it had more powers of the center, granted. It could operate on people directly, granted. You had this House of Representatives, which was more quote-unquote national than anything else, even though the states still got to determine who could vote, what the districts were going to be, all those kind of things. It was still based on states. But at the end of the day, it was still a principle of federalism. That's the only thing that allowed the Constitution to be ratified. And if we're going to be committed to originalism, if we're going to be committed to state powers, then you have to accept things that you don't like in other places. I'm not going to read the news stories that are out about this. There's tons of them. I mean, you've got Axios, you've got the Wall Street Journal, you've got all kinds of places coming out and reporting on this issue and very upset with Donald Trump for his statement. Of course, you've got people flip-flopping all over the place in Arizona. You've got things going on. This has created some... Is this going to be a political liability for the Republicans? That's another issue. Are the Republicans going to be faced with electoral defeat because of this? Is what the Republican Party is worried about. Are they going to get enough Republicans to vote for Trump because he's come out and taken a position that might be anti-Republican? Are they going to lose elections because lefties are going to be animated by this in a place like Arizona and they're going to run on this? We know that when the federal government started getting involved after the Dobbs decision and started saying we need to have federal legislation on this issue, we know that it did animate some people to go out and vote against Republicans if they actually physically voted. But we know that happened. We know that happened. So this was, I mean, this is 2022. You know, we know this did happen in some places, though maybe a little exaggerated. We also know it worked the other direction, too. People were animated by saying, hey, we can do whatever we want in our states now. We don't have these restrictions from the Supreme Court anymore. We're going to go out and do what we'd like here. But we also know in places like Kansas, I mean, even though this is a red state, well, the people wanted something else there. And it's pretty much died down because of that. But you see, anytime you can politicize something, anytime you can make it about the national against the state, Trump is right. You're talking about real democracy here, real direct democracy, particularly if it's a referendum or something like that, where people can just vote on it directly. Constitutional amendment in a state. The legislature? Think about your representative ratio in your state legislature. I know in mine it's about 30,000 to 1, which is what George Mason complained about, not really representative government, but what George Washington said, if we have representative government, well, that's okay. We can have Republican government with 30,000 to 1. We know in some states, though, it's close to like 2,000 to 1. We know in places like California, it's closer to 300,000 to 1, which isn't representative government. But it's better than in Washington, D.C., every single day of the week. So where do you have more power? And where is this issue better affected? And again, doesn't matter what happens if you live in California, what happens in Nevada. It doesn't matter what happens in Arizona. It doesn't matter what happens in Alabama or in Massachusetts. If you live in those other states, it doesn't matter what happens if you're in Massachusetts. It doesn't matter what happens in Florida. When you have this Lincolnian ideology of everything is in the center, we have to regulate everything from the center, that's when you get the most political chaos, the most political violence, because you are allowing people who don't live near you, who don't share your views, who aren't part of your political community. We can't have a republic of 320 million people. It's impossible. There's no Republican government there. The only thing you can have is centralized authority. And we've got, I mean, if the Democrats are going to preach diversity, then we've got places in the United States that are so diverse, so different, that it really doesn't, they aren't like you. And this is true. So do you want those people in those areas, in those states, dictating, those regions, dictating what you do in your state, in your region, based on your political culture? We know most Americans would say no. This is why we're having discussions of decentralization, secession, nullification, all these things, But what we really need to have a conversation about, all that stuff would go away if we just had a commitment to federalism. Arizona wouldn't even be an issue nationally. What Trump said would not even be controversial because people would say, well, yeah, this is what the Supreme Court said. The Supreme Court just basically said, look, Dobbs' decision, we're just going to return this back to the states where it belongs. There's no federal authority over this issue at all. It goes back to the states. If there wants to be a federal authority here, you have to come up with an amendment or something else, something that would give the general government the power over these issues. Really, what we need is a discussion about the powers of the general government and what they can and cannot do constitutionally, based on an original understanding of what the Constitution do. The 14th Amendment, we know, doesn't even apply here, because even in the Arizona situation, the law in question there is from 1864. Now, when the 14th Amendment was ratified, quote-unquote, supposedly in 1868, that law didn't go away. Of course not, because it wouldn't have impacted that particular law. So, these are the main questions. Mike Pence can feel slapped in the face all he wants. Steve Deese can get upset. But what Trump said was 100% consistent with the way the Constitution was ratified, and the 14th Amendment did not change any of that. Particularly if we follow the understanding of it, and of course the evidence that Raoul Berger points out in Government by Judiciary, and of course his follow-up book, The 14th Amendment. I mean, the evidence is clear. It doesn't do what all these people say it does. The 14th Amendment is not the Constitution. The Supreme Court interpreting the 14th Amendment is not the Constitution. The Constitution is very clear on these things. The federal government has no power. See you next time on the Brion McClanahan Show. See you then.